Here's a story of how I got the state of Ohio to pay for damage done to my vehicle by a pothole. First, I'm going to tell you about the damage to the car. Next comes the process of filing the claim. And then, how I had to open up a can of Johnny Cochran after the state denied my claim the first time, eventually receiving a full reimbursement. You might want to grab yourself a beverage. This is going to be a long one. Let me begin by showing you my 2006 Acura TSX. I just put coilovers and BBS 18-inch wheels on the car in August of 2014 and couldn't have been happier with the results. About a month later, on October 9th, I was traveling south on I-77 around 9 p.m. When on the exit 137A overpass, I hit a pothole, which caused the worst sound I have ever heard or felt in my TSX. Immediately, I noticed a slight vibration in the steering wheel and a car wanting to pull slightly to the left. Keep in mind, I had just had the car aligned after installing the new suspension and freshly balanced wheels a month earlier. I pulled over at the next exit and looked at the front suspension in the dark with my phone light, and nothing was obviously loose or broken. Continuing on my drive home, I noticed that the front of the car felt like it was floating. When I got home, I found that the front lift shock had no dampening ability and the adjustment screw at the top made no difference at all. I immediately ordered a replacement, which cost $120. Two of the BBS wheels were ever so slightly bent. Rather than purchase two new 18-inch BBS RSGT wheels at $800 each, yes, $800 per wheel, and risk not being reimbursed for the damage, I had them balanced out at the alignment shop in Talmadge, Ohio, where I take all my lower cars to be aligned. I did talk to a couple of repair shops, both of which did not think the bends were worth fixing and risking good damage to the finish of the wheels. The total for balancing of the two wheels and the alignment was $114.04, for a grand total of $234.04. When looking to be reimbursed, the first step is to find out who is responsible for the area in which the pothole was located. It could be a township, city, county, or in my case, because it was on an interstate, the Ohio Department of Transportation, aka ODOT. I found ODOT's website by Googling Ohio Department of Transportation. However, didn't find any way to submit a claim on the site's homepage. It wasn't until I added claim into my original Google search that Google showed me a direct link to their claim page. On October 10th, I submitted the claim online and immediately received an automated email letting me know my claim had been received, followed by a more helpful email in a few days from a human explaining the exact steps needed to file a court of claims action against the state of Ohio, i.e. ODOT. It was pretty straightforward, but she did let me know there was a $25 filing fee, which I would be reimbursed for if my claim was approved. So I went on over to the Ohio Court of Claims site, downloaded the form, and filled it out as follows. Name, address, telephone, and then the defendant and their address. And then down by number 12, describe in ordinary language the basis of the claim. So I put driving southbound on I-77 around 10 p.m. on October 9th, 2014, I drove over a large pothole in the road, followed immediately by a large bump going across the road. This was in the middle lane, where the overpass joins the grounded section of the highway. I felt the large jolt from the impact and a loud clunk noise. Noticed a slight vibration and car pulled slightly to the left after. Car just had new shocks, tires, and alignment done about 1 month earlier. Farther down on section 13, causing the plaintiff following injury, damage, or loss. Front left shock impact caused damage to unit. Order replacement online for $120 and replaced myself. Two wheels were slightly bent, causing a vibration. Rather than replace, I had them balanced out when the car was realigned. Total for balance and alignment was $114.04, for a total of claim $234.04. And it was just me in the car, so there was no witness to fill in for number 15. On the next page, they ask about my insurance provider and my deductible, which was $750, so I obviously did not make an insurance claim on this. They also ask that I include any receipts and photos, so I attached both of my receipts and I took some pictures of the damage to the wheel, which you saw earlier, as well as the Google Street View, which was also noted that it was updated August of 2014, and then an overall shot just to show where on the highway it was. The only copies I had were the black and white Xerox ones, which they sent back to me. But important note, the original photos that I sent to them looked just like this and were as clear as day. After a few months of waiting, a note from my mail carrier letting me know that I had certified mail from the Court of Claims of Ohio showed up in my mailbox. I went down to my local post office that Saturday and signed for it, hoping to find a check inside. It was replied to my claim, which, in a nutshell, was ODOT telling me that it was not negligent in maintaining the road, and that the road was in good condition at the time of my incident, because I did not point out how long the pothole existed prior to this incident. However, if you recall on the claim, I attached a Google Street View screenshot showing the pothole clearly dated August of 2014. Well, I guess that wasn't good enough for ODOT. Here's the full report. Defendant, Ohio Department of Transportation, through its director, Jerry Ray, makes the following investigation report in response to plaintiff's complaint. Blanks 1 through 5, defendant has no reason to question the information contained in these blanks. 6 through 9, same thing. 10 through 11, same thing. Now, 12 is where I wrote my statement. And they say see attachments for that. Blank 13 through 21, no reason to question anything there. So, let's see. On to the next page. Plaintiff alleges that October 9th, 2014, around 10 p.m. while driving southbound on 77, he drove over a pothole. Basically, this is just my story here. And let's see, defendant shows area of incident was mile marker 23.21. Here we go. This section of roadway on Interstate Route 77 has an average daily traffic count between 49,970 and 54,000 vehicles, according to the 2013 average daily traffic report. The Department of Transportation's investigation reveals that ODOT had no notice of a pothole on Interstate Route 77 in the area of plaintiff's incident prior to plaintiff's incident. See Exhibit C. Because ODOT did not receive notice of the subject condition prior to the time in question, defendant has no way of knowing or determining exactly how long the pothole existed prior to plaintiff's incident. Since defendant is not aware of any incidents at or near the location, it is more likely than not that the pothole existed in that location for only a relatively short amount of time before the plaintiff's incident. Defendant maintains that plaintiff has failed to prove by preponderance of the evidence that the Department of Transportation, in a general sense, maintains its highways negligently. Plaintiff has failed to introduce evidence which affords a reasonable basis for the conclusion that it is more likely than not that the conduct of ODOT was the cause of plaintiff's incident. Defendant wishes to point out that defendant's Summit County manager conducts roadway inspections on all state roadways within the county on a routine basis, at least 1 to 2 times a month. This includes Interstate Route 77, which has an average daily traffic count of between 49,970 and 54,000 vehicles. The Department of Transportation's investigation reveals that ODOT had received 0 complaints of potholes on IR-77 in the area of plaintiff's incident prior to plaintiff's incident within the past 6 months. See Exhibit C. Because ODOT did not receive notice of the subject condition prior to the time in question, defendant has no way of knowing or determining exactly how long the pothole existed prior to plaintiff's incident. Since defendant is not aware of any incidents at or near the location, it is more likely than not that the pothole existed in that location for only a relatively short amount of time before plaintiff's incident. Defendant maintains that plaintiff has failed to prove, by a preponderance of the evidence, that the Department of Transportation, in a general sense, maintains its highways negligently. Plaintiff has failed to introduce evidence which affords a reasonable basis for the conclusion that it is more likely than not that the conduct of ODOT was the cause of plaintiff incident. So they basically said the exact same thing 2 times. Continuing on, a review of the 6-month maintenance history for the area in question reveals that over 270 maintenance operations were conducted on IR-77 in Summit County. See Exhibit D. Defendant maintains that if ODOT personnel had detected any defects, they would have been promptly scheduled for repair. And then they go on to cite a previous case. Going on to the next page, defendant maintains that it is not an insurer of the highways, nor believes that it was negligent in respect to the maintenance of the area in question. Conclusion, defendant did not receive any complaints or otherwise have notice of subject condition prior to plaintiff's incident. Plaintiff has presented no evidence to indicate how long the pothole existed in the roadway prior to his incident. Now, time out. You did see August of 2014, so we knew it was there at least a month, which would have meant that if the area was surveyed twice a month, it should have been seen two times. Continuing on, the roadway was in relatively good condition at the time of plaintiff's incident. There were over 270 maintenance operations on IR-77 in Summit County in the past six-month period. Defendant conducted roadway inspections on a routine basis. For the foregoing reasons, defendant moves this court to dismiss plaintiff's cause of action for failure to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. I hereby certify that the above statements are true to the best of my knowledge. The end. So I didn't even bother scanning all their exhibits because they were pretty much pointless. They just have a list of different repairs over Summit County over a certain amount of time. I believe it was the last 6 months. Different complaints. Let's see. More complaints. And maintenance history. Everything from pothole patching to drainage to mowing. Picking up litter. Traffic control. Guardrail, sign maintenance, and then this last page is more maintenance history. And I don't doubt that they do spend a lot of time maintaining the highway, but we all know a pothole doesn't form over just a few weeks at the end of summer. So I was upset, to say the least. I wasted all that time, plus I was out an additional $25 for the filing fee. I felt as if my evidence was more than enough. I mean, you can't get any more accurate than Google Street Maps, dated and all. They seem to completely overlook that important piece of evidence. Now, fueled by rage, I tap into my inner Johnny Cochran. I immediately began taking down ideas from response to the investigation report. I had 21 days to give my response to the clerk, or else I would need to submit a request for an extension, which I ended up doing to get some additional time to build my case. Now, the Court of Claims had a very specific requirement for the format to request the extension and also the format of the response. I was sure to follow these to the T so that there would be no reason for them to toss out my response. After much investigating, learning lawyer speak, and gathering information, I was writing my response, which should convince anyone short of a zombie that the state was clearly in error by denying my claim. It went like this. Thank you for taking the time to write a detailed investigation report for my case. I agree with some of the information in the report, including the information in Exhibit A and statistics in Exhibit B. In the defendant's conclusion, it is stated that defendant did not receive any complaints or otherwise have notice of subject condition prior to plaintiff's incident. I agree with the defendant's statement. However, it is because of the negligence of the Department of Transportation and the Summit County manager that the defendant was not notified of the condition of the roadway. I have evidence to prove this in my full response below. I disagree with the defendant's statement that the roadway was in relatively good condition at the time of plaintiff's incident. I will provide photographs of the pothole existing as far back as July 2014, exactly as appeared at the time of the incident. First, on page 1, paragraph 3, the defendant states, because ODOT did not receive notice of the subject condition prior to the time in question, defendant has no way of knowing or determining exactly how long the pothole existed prior to plaintiff's incident. Since defendant is not aware of any incidents at or near the location, it is more likely than not that the pothole existed in the location for only a relatively short amount of time before plaintiff's incident. In the original evidence mailed with the complaint, I did provide proof that the pothole existed in August 2014 by including imagery from Google Street View dated August 2014. The pothole is clearly visible in those photographs. Allow me to explain more about how Google Street View works. Google Street View is a technology featured in Google Maps and Google Earth that provides panoramic views from positions along many streets in the world. It was launched in 2007 in several cities in the United States and has since expanded to include cities and rural areas worldwide. Data capturing equipment used on Google Map camera cars, see Exhibit A, produces images from several generations of camera systems developed in-house. Recorded photographs must be associated with accurate positioning. This is done via a global positioning system, wheel speed sensor, and inertial navigation sensor data. Laser range scanners from SICK-AG for the measuring of up to 50 meters, 180 degrees in front of vehicle. These are used for recording the actual dimensions of the space being photographed. See Exhibit B. The equipment is capable of capturing fine details such as pedestrians' faces, license plates, and house numbers, which Google automatically blurs for privacy reasons. The images in Google Street View are also high enough of a resolution to show the texture in the asphalt on the surface of the road, clearly showing any imperfections or damage, such as a pothole. See Exhibit C. In 2012, Google began dating all of the Street View images as explained by a private investigator in Investigative Tip, Date and Time on Google Maps Street View, see Exhibit D, and Google Community Leader, see Exhibit E. As of 2014, street-level imagery from the past can now be seen if available for a given street view. This is only available where Google has imaged a street more than once. See Exhibit F. This is very important to my case, as I recently discovered this feature and have used it to look as far back as July 2014, which shows the pothole is still as clearly visible as it was in the month of October. Upon learning this, I discovered that a Google Maps camera car traveled past the site of the incident and captured imagery of the pothole in July, see Exhibit G, August, see Exhibit H, September, see Exhibit I, and October, see Exhibit J, of 2014. The detail of the pothole is visible in the image from each month, leading up to my incident on October 9th, 2014. Unfortunately, the saved Street View image prior to July 14 is from August 2011, as Google cars did not always travel through this area on a regular basis. However, we know that a pothole does not simply appear during summer. It has most likely been there since the beginning of spring 2014, as stated on the Summit County Engineers website. Why do potholes form? Why do they always happen in the spring? Potholes are holes in the roadway that vary in size and shape. They are caused by the expansion and contraction of groundwater after the water has entered into the ground under the pavement. When water freezes, it expands. The same effect happens when water gets into the ground under the pavement. If it has a chance to freeze, it will take up more space under the pavement, and the pavement will expand, bend, and crack, which weakens the material pavement. Then, when ice melts, the pavement contracts and leaves gaps or voids in the surface under the pavement where water can get in and be trapped. If the water freezes and thaws over and over, the pavement will weaken and continue cracking. As the weight of cars and trucks pass over the weak spot in the road, pieces of the roadway material weaken, which will cause the material to be displaced or broken down from the weight, creating the pothole. What happens when salt is brought into the picture? Water will freeze at 32 degrees Fahrenheit. When salt is used, it lowers the temperature that water will freeze. This creates an artificial freeze-thaw cycle that permits more occurrences of the damaging cycle to occur. This happens more often in the spring because of the melting that takes place and because the temperature is fluctuating above and below the freezing point very frequently. See Exhibit K. In the defendant's conclusion, it is stated that defendant did not receive any complaints or otherwise have notice of subject condition prior to plaintiff's incident. I must disagree with the defendant's statement. The defendant must have known that this area of the road was in poor condition for quite some time because on October 10th, 2014, one day after my incident at this location, the Summit County Weekly Traffic Advisory website stated, beginning Friday, October 10th, and continuing through Friday, October 17th, The following areas will have various nightly lane restrictions between the hours of 8 p.m. and 6 a.m. for pavement repairs. I-77 northbound and southbound at State Route 18. See Exhibit L. I-77 southbound at State Route 18 is exit 137A, exactly where my vehicle was damaged by the pothole. I went to the site again in mid-October to find that nothing had changed. I drove by again in November to find that the entire four lanes of the road had been repaired. I'm pleased to see that the repair has been completed, preventing future motorists from damaging their vehicles at this location. However, the poor condition of this area of I-77 must have been known for quite some time in order to plan out the pavement repairs for this entire area and have them on the Ohio Department of Transportation's website on October 10, 2014. Defendant stated in the fifth paragraph of the report that defendant's Summit County manager conducts roadway inspections on all state roadways within the county on a routine basis, at least one to two times a month. This includes IR-77, which has an average daily traffic count of between 49,970 and 54,000 vehicles. Conducting roadway inspections at least one to two times per month means that this area has been neglected multiple times over the months prior to the incident. I have photographic evidence of the pothole in July, August, September, and October of 2014. One can see by the evidence that the pothole was in the same damaged state that it was when it damaged my vehicle as far back as July. Based on the "Why do potholes form? Why do they always happen in the spring?" article, we know that the pothole formed in the early spring or prior, when temperatures were still below freezing. I would also like to evaluate the defendant's statement on the number of motorists that travel this area and why no prior reports being filed is not a valid reason to deny that this pothole existed, but rather an unacceptable excuse for the defendant's own negligence. The lane with the pothole was second from the left on a four-lane section of I-77 southbound. So, of the 49,970 to 54,000 vehicles traveling daily on this highway, there would be only about 25% of those vehicles that would be traveling in the second lane from the left, where the pothole was located. Next, we must consider that some of those vehicles may not have been positioned within the lane to hit the pothole with their left wheel. Vehicles' front left tire may have driven to the left or right side of the pothole, especially by swerving during daylight hours when the pothole was visible. Still though, there must have been some other motorists besides myself who encountered this pothole. Let's consider the type of vehicles on the highway. A semi-truck, box truck, SUV, pickup truck, large car, or mid-sized car all have larger wheels and tires than a small car such as mine, and a longer travel suspension, which would lessen the impact to the tire, wheel, suspension, and steering components attached to the hub axle of that wheel hitting the pothole. Vehicles larger than mine may have not received noticeable damage if they were to hit this pothole, making no reason to file a report. Let's say another motorist with a small car, such as mine, was in the same lane at night as I was and did not see the pothole ahead and hit it square on, causing damage to vehicle as it did to mine. They most likely contacted their insurance company and filed a claim or paid out of pocket to get the damage repaired. I have a $700 deductible, so it only made sense that I would pay out of pocket rather than filing a claim through insurance. Of those motorists who actually had to go through this, how many are actually online savvy and aware that one can report a pothole online and have the time and knowledge to research and complete the process? There's not even a link or mention of reporting a pothole on the Ohio Department of Transportation's homepage. See Exhibit M. While it is impossible to acquire an exact amount of motorists for this statistic, simple logic by narrowing down the categories and scenarios mentioned above shows that the actual number of motorists willing to go through the process I have gone through is a small fraction of the vehicles traveling this highway daily. Looking at page 2 of defendant's CIMS complaint summary, is it a coincidence that I was only the 11th motorist to file a pothole report by the date of my incident in 2014? Anyone who travels in Summit County highways is well aware that there were a lot more than 11 potholes which could damage a vehicle. Perhaps if it were more publicly advertised, such as roadside signs and easily accessible, without having to take the time to research how to do so, more people would file reports when they encounter a pothole, lifting the burden of the Summit County manager who conducts roadway inspections on all state roadways within the county on a routine basis, at least 1 to 2 times a month, clearly missing a pothole would damage my vehicle. I would suggest using technology available today to help locate and determine potholes. There are smartphone apps which can be run in the background while driving, which use the phone's accelerometer, a motion detector, to sense when a bump is hit. GPS records the location and the phone transmits it to a remote server. The system can filter out things such as manhole covers and speed bumps using a series of logarithms, including one that can tell if the initial motion is up over a speed bump as opposed to down into a pothole. If a certain number of people hit a bump in the same spot, the system recognizes it as a pothole. Everyone in the department could run this app or even offer the app as a free download to motorists who commute every day. To save the money and time this incident has cost me, I would gladly use such an app while driving. Imagine the money and time saved by creating a real-time app of potholes that need to be fixed and eliminating the need to send out trucks or workers to patrol hundreds of miles of roads looking for damage. Boston was the first city to do this, and the feedback results were exponentially better than continuing to do it the old-fashioned way. Street Bump is the name of one such app, if you would like to further look into this. It could very well be because of the process required to file a complaint through ODOT and the outdated methods the defendant uses to acquire information on the location and severity of a pothole, such as the one which damaged my vehicle on October 10, 2014, that the defendant claims they had no notice of this condition prior to the incident. Conclusion. I have provided photographic evidence of the pothole existing as far back as July 2014, despite the defendant's denial of said pothole and claims of the Summit County Manager conducting roadway inspections on all state roadways within the county on a routine basis, at least 1 to 2 times a month. The defendant must have known that this area of I-77 was in poor condition for quite some time in order to plan out the pavement repair process for I-77 and State Route 18 where the pothole existed, and have been posted on the Ohio Department of Transportation's website as of October 10, 2014. I have also shared logical reasoning as to why the defendant cannot depend on motorists to notify the defendant of potholes neglected by ODOT. Finally, by raising awareness of the pothole reporting program and making potholes and road damage easier for motorists to report to ODOT, while using current technology instead of relying on the Summit County Manager to see potholes when patrolling the roads 1 to 2 times a month, incidents such as this one could be avoided in the future. I hereby certify that all the above statements are true to the best of my knowledge.
Order in this court! Order in this court!
In mid-April, I received another letter from the Court of Claims. This one not certified mail. It was the memorandum decision in my favor. Plaintiff filed this claim on December 22, 2014 to recover damages which occurred when his 2005 Acura struck a large pothole while traveling southbound on Interstate 77 on October 9, 2014 in Summit County, Ohio. This road is a public road maintained by the Ohio Department of Transportation. Plaintiff's vehicle sustained damages in the amount of $234.04. Plaintiff maintains a collision deductible in the amount of $750. In order to recover on a claim for roadway damages against the Ohio Department of Transportation, Ohio law requires that a motorist slash plaintiff prove all of the following. 1. The plaintiff's motor vehicle received damages as a result of coming into contact with a dangerous condition on a road maintained by the defendant. 2. That the defendant knew or should have known about the dangerous road condition. 3. That the defendant, armed with this knowledge, failed to repair or remedy the dangerous condition in a reasonable time. In this claim, the court finds that the plaintiff did prove that his vehicle received damages and that those damages occurred as a result of the plaintiff's vehicle coming into contact with a dangerous condition on a road maintained by the defendant. The next element that a plaintiff must prove to succeed on a claim such as this is to show that the defendant knew or should have known about this dangerous condition. Based on the evidence presented, the court is unable to find that the defendant had actual knowledge of the dangerous condition. However, if there is reason to believe that a party should have known about a dangerous condition, that party may be charged with constructive notice of the condition. Constructive notice is defined as notice arising from the presumption of law from the existence of facts and circumstances that a party has a duty to take notice of. Notice presumed by law to have been acquired by a person and thus imputed to that person. In order for there to be a constructive notice, a plaintiff must prove that sufficient time has passed after the dangerous condition first appears, so that under the circumstances, the defendant should have gained knowledge of its existence. In this case, the plaintiff submitted Google Earth photographic images taken in August, September, and October 2014 that clearly shows the pothole in question that caused plaintiff's accident. These photographs are persuasive to the court that the defendant at least should have had knowledge that this dangerous highway condition was in existence on October 9, 2014, the date of the accident in question. Therefore, the court finds that the agency was negligent in failing to repair this pothole in a reasonable time, and thus the court will find in favor of the plaintiff. Plaintiff's repair costs were $234.04, and his insurance deductible is $750. Ohio law requires recoveries against the state to be reduced by any available insurance. As plaintiff's recovery is therefore limited to his losses of $234 plus a $25 filing fee, which may be reimbursed as compensable damages pursuant to Holding and Bailey v. Ohio Department of Rehabilitation and Correction, blah, 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 blah. Having considered all the evidence in the claim file and for the reasons set forth in the memorandum decision filed concurrently herewith, judgment is rendered in favor of plaintiff in the amount of $259.04, which includes a filing fee. Court costs are assessed against defendant. Around the third week of June, I received the check for $260.32. Hey guys, thanks for watching that whole video. I just want to say that I am a graphic designer slash photographer. I'm not an attorney. I tried to be an attorney a couple times in my late teens, early 20s, when I had some moving violations to fight in court and I lost every one. So this is my first success at actually winning something in court. And being an attorney, it's kind of fun, and doing the investigating, I like that. And this was a fun exercise. You know, I like gathering clues and researching and putting things together. And being an attorney, it's kind of a fun challenge because you have to tell someone that they're a liar or that they're just an idiot in a very civil manner with supporting facts. Now, I'm a nice guy. I'm an honest guy. And I wasn't trying to come off as a jerk to, you know, the state of Ohio or ODOT or the county summit manager slash engineer. But, I mean, they obviously knew that the road was damaged, especially since less than 12 hours after my incident, when I looked at the website, they had already slated that that area was up for pavement repair. So it's obvious. And, you know, in defense of ODOT and Ohio, everybody, I'm sure they get a lot of requests for claims. So maybe it's their standard practice to deny everybody in the first round. So just those who are really serious or aren't trying to scam the system come back and then try and win again. So I don't know how the system exactly works, but this is how it worked out for me. Now I think the most important information that I used was thanks to Google Street Maps and going back in time with those dates and seeing the condition of the road. I think that's going to be your biggest advantage when it comes to gathering information if you're fighting a case and trying to make a claim, such as I did. The other information I used was really their own information that they presented to me that I turned and used back on them. And the advantage to using their own information that they gave you and turning it around, using it back on them, is they can't question that because that's their information. And that included the How Do Potholes form that proved that the pothole didn't just suddenly appear in summer. There was the statistics which they used, and then also just the whole way that the potholes are to be reported, which really, if you think about it, is outdated. And I think by suggesting the more modern way, that kind of made them realize that. Now, every case is different, so you know I encourage you to do your research and use anything you've seen in my video to get some ideas to build your own case for your own claim, and make sure you hit them hard. Good luck.